We Are the World. I don't know how old you are if you're listening, but if you're as old as I am, of course you remember that phrase as the title of a song that sort of brought the world together around famine relief in the 80s by predominantly American artists. It's not a new term. It's something you've probably heard before. It's usually sort of around the idea of kumbaya stuff that, you know, kind of we're all in this together. But what if I told you that We Are the World is literal, not figurative. It's scientific, not ethereal. Well, we're going to discuss that very possibility tonight with our guest, Roger Nelson, from the Global Consciousness Project. Tonight on What in the World, Sirius XM, Canada Talks, Channel 167. Welcome back to the show. And this is a show I'm very excited about. And again, I've said that before, and I want to be clear to all my guests that I'm always excited to do every show because we get to talk about really fascinating, cool, amazing, transcendent things on this show. That's, you know, basically what the foundation of What in the World is all about, talking about the fascinating, the unexplained, and the underexplained. And that's a term that I don't think gets used enough. And, you know, my sort of definition of that is are things that are out there that actually have a pretty significant background of whether it be scientific research, studies, et cetera, yet for reasons that, you know, we can discuss today and also on another show, you know, as to why the world is the way it is and if things don't fit into the current paradigm, how they get marginalized, ridiculed, pushed to the side, etc. One of those things would be the idea of global consciousness. It sounds very ethereal. It sounds very esoteric, and it certainly doesn't sound like something that's quote-unquote testable, quantifiable, measurable. So, again, it gets relegated to the bin of para this or pseudo that or whatever derogatory term might come from the institutions of science and establishment. But what would surprise many of you, I think, is that there has been very relevant, very significant, and acknowledged studies done around the idea that there is a global consciousness, a collective consciousness, and that being something that we would all share. It does not eliminate our individual consciousness. It is not a Borg idea from Star Trek, as some people might, you know, jump to that conclusion in a panicked sort of way. What we're talking about is, you know, really something almost abstract in that it's kind of, you know, two things at once. It's up and down, black and white. In this case, it's individual as well as shared. And again, like I said, not only has this been the purview of some really, you know, great scientific minds, people like Dr. Amit Goswami comes to mind, who's really sort of gone down that road of the science of consciousness. And this is something that's fast becoming not only less marginalized and dismissed, but being taken up by more and more people around the world. Well, somebody who kind of got things started and was, you know, ahead of the game, so to speak, and I would guess probably had to have a certain amount of courage to even embark on this scientific journey, especially being at an Ivy League school. But that's our guest today. It's Roger Nelson, who is a PhD, was the coordinator of research at the Princeton Engineering Anomalies Research Laboratory at Princeton University from 1980 to 2002. And he has directed the Global Consciousness Project, which we're going to talk about a little more, since its inception in 1997. And he does a lot of work today with the Institute of Noetic Sciences, which is kind of the hub now of the Global Consciousness Project. So we want to welcome him to the show, not only because he provides, I think, great, great information analysis as a great guest, but really, to me personally, I look back on this work that's been done and what's continuing to be done is probably something that history will look back on as a seminal turning point if we're around in 50 years. But we can get into that with our guest today. Welcome to the show, Dr. Nelson. How are you?
Thank you, Richard. That's quite an introduction, and I appreciate it very much.
There's a lot. There's a lot there, right? I mean, it's an interesting thing, and that's probably why we do this show, is because the things that do require a little more context and maybe a little more explanation and can't just be summarized in a couple of sound bites on CNN often do get relegated just for that reason alone. But the work you've been doing, again, let's be clear, as a hardcore scientist here, somebody who respects the scientific method, who comes from that background, has really led you to believe and that there is an interconnection of not just human beings, but pretty much everything on this planet and probably in this universe. Why did you go down this road back a couple of decades ago?
Well, I started thinking about consciousness in a kind of individual sense. What can it do? What are the boundaries? And what's beyond the boundaries that we usually use to circumscribe something like consciousness? And it became apparent in the work we did at the Pear Lab that consciousness is absolutely not stuck in your head. It's not confined to your skull, your body, but extends out and mingles with other consciousness, and it also interacts with the physical environment in which we find ourselves. And these are phenomena that can be tested scientifically. We find the evidence for those things is very good. What we also find is that the effects that we can measure, given the tools that we have, are very small. And I think that last point is one of the reasons why so many scientists and others feel that the evidence is poor. We aren't able to, for example, produce a consciousness effect that will open your garage door or change your TV channel. It's not that kind of thing. But if we properly understand the science, I think it could change our understanding of basically the scientific models. They don't incorporate consciousness, and human beings ought to be a little offended or at least a little concerned about that, because it's the direct, most amazing a product of the complexity that constitutes a human being that we find. In other words, we are conscious. We know we are. We think about who am I and why am I here and those kinds of things. And that all is very direct, very apparent to us and not included in our scientific models. So there are people, you mentioned the Institute of Noetic Sciences. There are a number of organizations around the world, and there are people like me, and I wish there were more, but there are hundreds of other scientists who respect the scientific method who are very much interested in trying to sort of rectify that situation, to gather the evidence and then to work up the models and theories that will allow us to put consciousness on the scientific map.
We've had a lot of people on this show that would fall into that category. I mentioned Dr. Amit Goswami. We've had Dean Radin on as well. And we had Sir Roger Penrose on last year. And, you know, for the people who are listening who aren't familiar with Roger Penrose, he is the author of the Penrose-Hawking theory of singularity. And really, if you saw the movie Theory of Everything, I think it was called, the dramatic scripted movie about the life of Stephen Hawking last year, you would see that actually it was Penrose who inspired you know, the original theories of Hawking. So Penrose, you know, again, I'll defer to him, right? This is a physicist who's knighted, who's been in a, you know, a laboratory for probably 50 years plus. And as his career, you know, enters maybe, you know, its final seasons, he's essentially made news in the last few years of stating that basically we kind of got it wrong, one. And two, that it's quite possible that consciousness is that underlying theory of everything, the unified field, whatever you want to call it, that everyone's looking for. Not, he's not definitive about anything, but he's certainly at least demonstrating an open mind towards that idea, not because he's some, you know, pot-smoking hippie, or not because he's prone to default to ethereal or esoteric ideas, but because the overwhelming evidence of years and years of his laboratory study have suggested, as it did for Einstein, as it did for Planck, as it did for many other prominent physicists, that after a while they have to acknowledge that there's an underlying informational field, something that informs absolutely and animates everything that exists, and that could very well be consciousness. So if these guys are coming around, let's say, and, you know, again, like you said, there's more and more prominent people who are investigating this with serious study, why is it then still that it's still something that, you know, as a member of the scientific community, you really can't talk about?
Well, I can't speak for all those people who refuse to look at the questions, but they are difficult questions. We're not talking about something you can go into the lab and turn on a switch and achieve an answer. We're not even talking about something that's like the Large Hadron Collider, the CERN machine that costs billions of dollars. That you can go in and turn on a switch, and eventually you get some kind of blips on the screen, and it happens that it takes a lot of statistical work, deep scratching, to find out if there's anything there, and then to theorize what it means. Well, we don't have such a machine for consciousness, except our own, you know, internal laboratories, and which makes me think I should mention that people like Roger Penrose and the patriarchs of physics, who are by no means alone. They're by no means early arrivals on this scene. Human beings have understood for all of the time we have been conscious that consciousness is real, that it actually is meaningful, and they have, if we look into the traditions of all religions and all cultures, we find that the idea of interconnection, you mentioned, and which I think is one of those, you know, the words that we could put out a kind of bumper sticker version of what we're talking about here. Interconnection is real. We are interconnected, and we have always been. It's unfortunately for the scientific mind a little difficult to see. If you have to look down into the unconscious and the implicit in order to recognize that there is something that is common to humankind, and as you also mentioned, that interconnection is not only among people but among all the creatures of the planet, and is probably as you were suggesting, something that's extremely fundamental. We don't understand that yet, but I think that we're on the first steps of a journey that will bring us to an understanding that not only includes consciousness, but sees it as a kind of fundamental property of the universe.
Yeah, and I couldn't be more excited to hear you say that, and because it rings true, it feels true, and again, I don't want to say the expiration date on the sort of Newtonian classical physics viewpoint, a limited viewpoint, in my opinion, of the world that we live in, it's certainly, you know, they're not, the fat lady isn't singing on that, let's say, but more and more people are emerging every day with at least something of an understanding that there's got to be infinitely more than that. We're going to talk about that on the other side of break with our guest today, Dr. Roger Nelson. It is What in the World, Sirius XM, channel 167. Welcome back to the show. Our guest today, Dr. Roger Nelson of the Global Consciousness Project. If you haven't heard about it yet, you will. And if it sounds like something that kind of maybe captures your attention in a way that you might not have otherwise been captured, then, you know, I think there's a reason for that. And we can talk about the very idea of collective consciousness being not only something real, but something that's being measured, albeit at a nascent stage in terms of sort of scientific quantification, but nevertheless, some significant findings that would certainly at least point you in a direction that, again, as you were talking about earlier, Dr. Nelson, as technology, as other things develop, that we can sort of go to that next stage of measurement, then, you know, who knows how we're going to be able to do this. But one of the big barriers there, and we touched on a little bit before the break, and I know you talk about this a lot, but, you know, I'm personally, you know, the more I sort of, let's say, evolve, age, whatever you want to say, the more I'm starting to question the scientific method. And I know when I'm speaking to a scientist, you know, that's going to be a difficult debate to win. But
well, it's terribly shocking.
Well, bear with me first.
It's a wonderful set of tools.
Yes.
And sometimes it's applied very well. Sometimes it's misapplied. But you can't get around the fact that a well-done scientific experiment provides data and evidence that you otherwise don't have. And that provides a foundation on which you can make declarations about such things as, for example, the effect of consciousness on physical systems.
Mm-hmm. But what I would say to that is that yes, it does. It does provide those things that you just mentioned, but in a very limited and singular space, which is matter. If you don't have material evidence in our world, you don't have evidence. And when we're talking about these things that certainly transcend the physical, when we're in a world today where we understand infinitely more about quantum physics, we have people talking, you know, high-level scientific minds, credible scientific institutions talking about the very real possibility of holographic universe theory, et cetera, where, you know, string theory is a working theory in physics right now. And all of these things obviously step outside the bounds of the material world, the Newtonian physics of, you know, of that classical scientific world. And I guess my point is that how can this system that's essentially limited to the measurement of matter ever going to be useful in measuring things that are non-material? And by definition, unfortunately, then in our world, anything that is non-material is simply relegated to it's not real. And I'm struggling as we can see a world that's opening up more and more beyond those boundaries. Do we need to take a look at the scientific method and revise it and bring a different perspective into how we're going to be able to approach these, like in a world of nanotechnology, in a world of quantum computing, all of these things, it seems to me that we need to come up with a different and better way to maybe measure things that we currently can't measure in the sort of traditional sense.
Let me make a comment or two.
Sure.
First of all, I think the scientific method is complemented by other methods, not supplanted, not replaced, but complemented. That is to say, we can't get everything done that we want to do using just the, as you're describing it, kind of material-based scientific method. We need some other things, like a little heart and soul, one way to think about it. But let me give you another, you might say, in-between perspective, which is extremely important. That is to say, correlation. Now, any scientist will say correlation is not causation, and sometimes that's used as an argument to end an argument. But in fact, most of what we know in science derives from what literally are correlations. We don't necessarily measure the W particle that the Large Hadron Collider or the Higgs boson. We find correlations. And they become significant at a level that scientists believe is important enough to say, well, there's something real there. But the fact is, the evidence is still just correlation. Nobody has grabbed hold of the Higgs boson. They haven't put it into, you know, to a little package and sent it off someplace. It isn't going to be in a museum. It's been discovered via correlations. That's what most of science really is. Winds up being when you look at it more carefully. It isn't that we capture the material evidence so much as we capture the relationship between the question we're asking and the answer that we get from an experiment. And this is very much true in the consciousness sciences. We don't have an instrument that can measure the information field or consciousness field that may be responsible for changes in a random number generator, but we can devise an experiment that eliminates other possibilities and leaves basically only that mind is that my intentions, say, are correlated with the fact that the random number generator is producing more ones now than it ought to by chance. And we have to understand that that is evidence of a real fact in the world. It isn't material, you see, but it doesn't need to be material. We ultimately just have to repeat that experiment until we understand that we're looking at something real.
And let's talk about, yeah, absolutely. And it's a great segue into, you know, the Global Consciousness Project itself. You mentioned random number generators, which is really not something I'd ever heard of until, you know, understanding more about the work at the Institute of Noetic Sciences a few years back, and you know, understanding what they do. So I'm guessing most people or a lot of people aren't 100% sure what they do, but I think you can essentially surmise what it is: a random number generator. And
right, we can say in a simple way of thinking about it is it's a high-speed electronic coin flipper. You know, most people are familiar with flipping a coin,
sure,
heads tails. If it's a fair coin, you should get half heads and half tails. That's what a random number generator does, only very fast.
And so the super cool thing for anybody, again, now sort of gripping the steering wheel a little tighter around the idea of what you guys have done and look to measure over the years is these random number generators going off the charts and being anything but random at very specific events in human history where you'd be able to make a very strong case that the attention, let's say, or intention, or whatever you want to call it, the focus of the world was on a particular event. So the most famous of the data that you guys have extracted is, of course, around 9/11, September 11th, 2011, obviously. 2001. But clearly, it's easy to understand that of all the things that have maybe ever happened in this world, with the exception of maybe some World War II stuff, where everybody in the world was focused on this particular time and date for obvious reasons, and this really, at least initially, provided some head scratchers as far as where this random number generator ended up in terms of, again, providing information that was anything but random. Talk a little bit about that and then how that sort of correlates with the idea that there could be a collective consciousness that is influencing these random number generators.
Right. We have in the lab established that these random number generators could respond, in a sense, to people's intentions. If we wanted high numbers, we could get high numbers. To a small degree, but to a highly significant degree. And then we branched out and took these same devices into groups that were having rituals or listening to an absolutely fabulous, gripping concert, and found that, again, they moved a little bit. Even though nobody intended that they changed their behavior, they showed evidence of changed behavior. Now, the Global Consciousness Project is an extension of that to a large number of these devices, all independent, all high-quality random number generators placed all around the world, so we could ask this this next question. If we have individual consciousness changing the way the world is, if we have group consciousness that can be registered in these systems, what about a global consciousness? And as you say, we have looked at many events, the biggest and most potent of them, in terms of gathering people to feel emotions and have ideas that are very much synchronized by the events in the world, we found that these devices that are independent and separated by thousands of miles and highly professionalized random sources actually stopped being so random and instead became correlated with each other over these great distances. This is not something that should happen in the physical sciences model of the world, but it's something that does happen, not just on 9/11, but it has happened for something like 70% of 500 events that we've looked at, to a degree that we now have what most scientists consider to be highly significant, completely convincing evidence. Seven standard deviations of, away from what's expected of data like this, the sort of thing that it's actually stronger than this evidence for the Higgs boson that I mentioned earlier. In any case, what we're looking at apparently is a consciousness field generated from all of us having a kind of consciousness that's not confined to our bodies but extends out somewhat, actually interacting. Now, most of the time when we are conscious, our mind is out in the world a little bit and in principle could be interacting with some other mind, but for the most part it just kind of passes through like radio waves and TV waves pass through each other to get to your house and to your TV set. Mm-hmm. But on occasions when we are all sort of focused in the same direction, this interpenetration turns into an interaction. And the result is something that we think of as a kind of composite field comprised of the individual fields I'll use the technical term, zillions of people doing the same thing, feeling the same emotions, or sharing a kind of response. It isn't just tragic events like 9/11, but celebrations like New Year's, great religious gatherings like the Kumbh Mela in India, where 20 million people try to bathe in the Ganges to cleanse their spiritual being. And it happens for natural disasters like the earthquake that destroyed Haiti and created the tsunami in Japan, and so on. There are many, many occasions that really bring huge numbers of people to think and feel the same thing, to feel compassion for each other. And those kinds of events produce correlations between devices that are physical and which are normally random, but and they're also separated by great distances. It's a mystery in a certain sense how it actually happens. We can't describe that yet. But what we can say is the evidence is very good that these correlations arise because of human consciousness of great events.
Yeah, and type of thing you would expect to see on the 6 o'clock news, but I guess maybe not. It's significant is an understatement. We're going to get to that in a little more as to what the potential repercussions of understanding this better for our world is and or are, and ultimately, what are the barriers to get this to the next level of research and acceptance? More with our guest, Dr. Roger Nelson, on What in the World, Sirius XM Canada Talks, channel 167.
Hide my head, I wanna drown my sorrow. No tomorrow. No...
Don't you know? Talking about a revolution sounds. Don't you know, talking about a revolution, it sounds like a whisper while they're standing in the welfare lines.
Welcome back to What in the World, Sirius XM Canada Talks, channel 167. Our guest today, Roger Nelson, Dr. Roger Nelson, if you will, who is, the founder, I guess, of the Global Consciousness Project and still very involved in it. And, you know, spent years at Princeton University. And before we sort of continue on what you guys are doing today, where you see this going, and certainly what the potential applications are of this understanding. And I think, you know, again, I think we both would probably agree that they're transcendent. But, you know, first things first, getting this probably accepted, you know, at a scientific level, a little more across the board is probably step one. But so to that point, at Princeton, ironically, from my standpoint, you know, where a guy like Albert Einstein spent a lot of his time, what are the conversations that you would have with your peers around this idea? Because I get the feeling that off the record, you're going to get a lot more hard scientists that will sort of speak to the quote-unquote soft sciences as definitely things that, you know, there are big questions. You mentioned, you use the word mystery. But if you're talking about publishing a paper or being asked their opinion on something, often, even the work that you guys have done with the random number generators, et cetera, you know, a lot of the... you know, sort of resistance from, you know, other people who are asked to look at the data, et cetera. It's always interesting to me because it's not just dismissive, let's say, of the, whether it be the method or how the data was collected, et cetera. But where I always sort of get a bit of a spidey sense going on is when the attitude and the tone is not only dismissive, but marginalizing. Because to me, if you look back at our track record as a species here, and this is always just, I don't know the answer to how come we continue to be so utterly and completely resistant to new information as it comes, even though throughout history we know that every single bit of scientific information we've ever known or had has either been refuted outright with new information or revised, but essentially we've been wrong a lot. So why would we not look at this particular sort of new area, this new space, and say, wait a sec, this could be something that guides us to an entirely new, you know, new level of evolution for the species, looking beyond ourselves, even understanding network theory and seeing at a computer level how everything's sort of interconnected and networked. Is it not possible to say, well, wait a sec, maybe we're kind of wired the same, trees, nature works in that same way, but yet instead it's just, for the most part, usually ridiculed outright and resisted by hard scientists. What is your experience when you're speaking to these people sort of off the record about the work that you do?
It's an interesting question, and it's a kind of a serious commentary on what human beings are, not just scientists, but all of us, how conservative we are. Basically, we like what we understand, and we support and defend what we understand, and we find it difficult to branch out from that. You see that in everyday life. Advertising is designed to break that down somewhat. So instead of you know, grandma's homemade soap, we now have Tide, and so on. But the very interesting thing is that when speaking of colleagues, speaking of hard scientists who come to look at what we're doing, what we found in the PEAR lab was almost without fail, the really high-level, brilliant people, Nobel Prize winners, and people with fully established, strong reputations, those were the people who were actually interested, and they wanted to know how our experiments worked and what the evidence really was like. They were open-minded. I guess one might speculate that they were open-minded partly because they could afford it. Mm. They already had succeeded in the scientific world. It's the people that are still struggling and trying to make sure that their peers don't look down on them who felt that they have to be careful and couldn't possibly reveal any interest in these strange matters. Hmm. Now, that actually is a reflection of the real world in science, and it isn't just when dealing with the kind of things that we were studying. It has happened innumerable times in the history of science that, you know, germs were considered to be a ridiculous notion until they weren't. Mm. And meteorites were, and that is to say rocks falling from the sky, were considered to be an outrageous hoax until it was determined that they were in fact meteorites coming from the asteroid belt or whatever. So this is nothing new, but it's nothing that we know how to overcome very readily except through the process of gradual education. We are making progress in the sort of out of mainstream sciences. People like, well, the PEAR Lab managed to produce, publish a few times in mainstream journals. Dean Radin's work recently has been making it into mainstream journals and making some really useful contributions to thinking about such things as the way the physical effects, quantum physics may involve observation and that sort of thing. In fact, we're providing data for a theoretical stance that long-term theorists have known is necessary, but for which most people couldn't find, you know, any proof. So we are also making progress, I think, socially. It's not easy to perceive this, that we are somewhat more peaceful now in this time when we have little bits of hot war going on in various parts of the world. It is much less than it used to be. So I think there is some hope that humanity is beginning to be open to the possibility that we are all interconnected. That, in other words, the kind of work that the Global Consciousness Project does, the kind of evidence that we have, will have a better fit, will look a little bit more reasonable to people who are trying very hard to connect across national borders and across ethnic borders and so on. We're gradually moving. We have to move maybe faster if we're going to solve some of the problems that really look like looming disaster. And so I think the implications of work like we have been doing is, as you suggested before, very important. We have to do a better job of presenting that to the broad public. By the way, the broad public really grasped the idea of global consciousness. And, I think it was Robert Heinlein who had the term grok. The broad public can grok and understand this, whereas we have a little bit of more work to do with the scientific types. Mm. Humanity is ready for an understanding about the interconnectedness of all of us.
That's a very good point. That's because you can see that the evidence, you know, exists in pop culture and certainly the types of movies people look to digest and you know, behavior on social media, et cetera. I agree with you 100% that that notion would probably be, would probably test over 50%, I would think, if you asked, you know, most of, you know, a test sample of a few million or billion people on this planet, whether the idea that there's some sort of, you know, connection amongst us beyond just this idea that we're in our separate vehicles.
Bet on a bigger number than 50%, something I'd say getting right up into the 80s and 90s.
Wow. Well, I mean, I agree with you.
When I give talks or when I presume you'll get some feedback on this show, mm-hmm. Some of it may be scathing skepticism, but sure. Some of it will be people who said, thank goodness there's somebody talking about this.
Yeah.
We know how important it is. And things like Twitter is international.
Yeah.
Mobile phones, young people are connecting with people on the other side of the world. And they're developing a kind of universal language. And the topic is, how do we save ourselves and, you know, from a looming disaster? It's not strong enough yet to influence the corporate, indulgence of people who have more than they need and don't imagine and don't understand anything about the real world in which everybody else lives. Now, I don't want to get polemical, but there's a lot of corrective information that's available, but which is not being, let us say, not being presented in such a way that people on the other side of the fence are understanding it. Young people are way ahead of most of us in this regard.
Yeah, I find it interesting that the internet generation, the information generation, allowed for many institutional gatekeepers to be leapfrogged, let's say. The record industry, you know, we're talking a bit about, you know, sort of, you know, broadcast television, other institutions that have been just, you know, circumvented because people could go direct to the source. Yet the one place that remains unshakable, it seems, is that the only way for something to be accepted in our world scientifically still is the traditional, it's got to be published in these particular whatever, and if it isn't, it isn't real science. And I don't see that being consistent with this sort of revolution towards a more democratized look at things, but it still seems to be maybe the last domino to fall. Maybe that's a question for another show, but we'll come back with Dr. Nelson after the break, final segment, and just get sort of a vision as to where we see things going, where we see the work of the Global Consciousness Project going, and where we see the world going. After the break, it is What in the World, SiriusXM, Canada Talks, Channel 167. Welcome back to What in the World, SiriusXM, Channel 167. Our guest tonight, Dr. Roger Nelson, of the Global Consciousness Project. We've talked a little bit about some of the work that you've done, you know, in recent years, really some of the seminal work that's been done that's really created a level of excitement because, you know, for many years and decades, and you've even referred, let's say centuries, millennia, there have been people talking about this human interconnection, this oneness, if you will, throughout, you know, even the boundaries of this planet. But again, that's sort of relegated to the idea of myth of, you know, not really understanding science, so therefore substituting that with these, you know, crazy spiritual ideas. But generally speaking, there's something that seems to have been consistent, a thread throughout human history, that there is more to this idea that we're just running around as these sort of separate random meat suits bumping into each other, that there's more, that there's something that unites us even beyond the, you know, again, the sort of the esoteric idea of that, literally that there's something that underlies all of us. The Global Consciousness Project obviously has a mandate and an objective, and I'm guessing it's sort of in that area, Cole, but give us an idea of what you guys hope to accomplish with the work that you're doing and where you see things going.
Right. We were pretty much a scientific question for a number of years. But as time has gone on, the answer to the question has been so clear and so clearly states that that there is a kind of interconnection. I like the way you put that. We are not just individual entities running around completely unconnected with each other. Instead, we, so to speak, bump into each other. And in some sense, we become eventually aware that there is more than just this individuality. There is, we don't have to give up our individuality, but we do have to recognize that we are not just individuals, but we're members or parts of a huge composite, which is all of humanity and all of the universe, ultimately. Oneness is a wonderful word. It really does express very nicely what the Global Consciousness Project finds evidence for, and you speak in terms of a mandate. As time has gone on, and I've been personally convinced that the evidence is quite clear, I've shifted my attention more and more to trying to provide what amounts to a kind of education about the meaning of our data, so that people can not only listen to the ancient sages and the religious traditions talking about oneness, but say, here's some scientific evidence that it is true. What we've been thinking for these many millennia has some substantial presence in a scientific framework, too. I don't think, in a way, that we should forget that science itself is a rather new phenomenon. We've been conscious and thinking and wise in some ways for millennia, whereas science is still rather youthful. Mm-hmm. And it's a time, I think, for science to grow up and ask questions that have to do with who we are, what can we do about living up to the potential that we have as human beings. One of the things I would like to mention is about the data from the Global Consciousness Project is that when we separate the events into those which show certain kinds of characteristics, what kind of emotions are represented, we find that that compassion and related kinds of things like love, if they're represented in the events, those events tend to have larger effect sizes than others. And when I think about that for just a little bit, I realize that compassion is really an emotion that happens between and among people. It's not something you do all by yourself. You have to have some object of your compassion. So in other words, it's an emotion that connects. And it's like love. If we meet somebody and come to understand and deeply value that person, and our emotions may become what we call love at some point. And at that point, we have created something new. It wasn't there before. It's a kind of composite of two people. And compassion does the same kind of thing. When there is an event like a great tragedy, an accident that kills hundreds of people, or a 9/11, we feel deep compassion, and that binds us together in a way that the technical apparatus of the Global Consciousness Project can somehow respond to. There is a kind of structure present in the interconnected nature or status of a large number of people focused on the same event. That structure is information, and our network, which ordinarily just randomly bumbles on toward the future, seems to be able to absorb the information that's generated by human beings thinking and feeling together, and therefore become evidence for the fact that we create unconsciously, but very in a very real way, we create a kind of global consciousness.
Wow, perfect way to end the show. And again, Einstein referenced a couple times tonight because of the link you share with Princeton University, but it was him that said, and I'm probably paraphrasing, that you can't change the problems of the world with the same level of consciousness that created the problems. And this is exactly the type of work you guys are doing. So continued success with the Global Consciousness Project. We'll catch up with you down the line. Thanks for joining us tonight, Dr. Roger Nelson.
That you can't